Hello, everybody, and welcome to Cinema Savvy. I'm your host, George Aldridge, and today we continue the Infinity Saga Retrospective with Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Hello, everybody, and welcome back. I'm delighted to be joined by Jed and Neel for today's video. We are deeply into phase three now in this retrospective. It's crazy that we're kind of almost at the end. In the meantime, we're still very far away from that end. And it's in this very weird trance now where it's starting to catch up with me, the film release dates, rather than me being like a sort of 12, 13-year-old. It's now like adult George. So that's a kind of blessing, I think, with these. However, neither of you joined me on Guardians of the Galaxy 1, which was great. It was a great video. Not that you guys weren't there. However, it means I can spring this question on you both. I'm going to go to you, Jed, first. We've obviously got a competition of who's the favorite Avenger. We've got a clear winner at the moment. However, there's no Guardians on there. So I haven't asked anybody, who is your favorite Guardian of the Galaxy?
My favorite would probably be Groot, but I'm going to specify Baby Groot.
Absolutely. That is a perfect choice. Again, another new one. Neel, let me know yours, and I'll let you know if you have an all-round draw or not.
I think Rocket. I quite enjoy how much of a knob he is.
So, I don't have a graph. I'm not going to make one. They're not worth that. However, I had Drax as my favourite by Country Mile. I think in the last one, we've had Drax, Nebula, Baby Groot, Rocket. I think we had Rocket twice. I think Rocket's the winner. However, no one picked Gamora or Star-Lord, which maybe says a lot about their relationship. I don't know. But that's a nice little way to bring it into it. And as usual, before we get into the episode, I'm going to say there's a lot of Marvel stuff coming up on the channel. By the time this video comes out, I still think it's Falcon and Winter Soldier is still airing. So that's going to be happening a lot. And we've also got the other Marvel and Infinity Saga retrospective. So next up, we've got a Spider-Man Homecoming film, which we'll get to. Aside from that, there's plenty of other good ones coming after that. And I'm going to use this as well. If you're furious about my Spider-Man thoughts once again, then comment below your thoughts on how I'm wrong on our Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 video. And maybe don't join us for Homecoming, but I will be very polite on that one. And of course, if you like that, hit that subscribe button. We've got a lot more stuff on the way. And our social medias, you can get us on Facebook, Twitter, Letterboxd, that's Cinema Savvy. So that's the perfect way to find us. However, we're not here to talk Spider-Man Homecoming. We're not here to talk Spider-Man Far From Home or even Avengers Infinity War yet. We're talking Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, the film that was set a couple of months after Volume 1, they say now, don't they? Can you guys remember the first time you saw it or your sort of first time watching, if you enjoyed it or whatnot?
Yeah, I remember the first time I saw it in cinemas, sort of opening weekend. And I remember coming out and feeling a bit disappointed by it. I didn't love it as much as the first one. I thought it was one of the weaker MCU films, but then as I've rewatched it, it's got better and better, and now it's one of my favourites.
Same. I watched it in cinema as well, and I watched it with Charlie, who's his film's channel, and a few other friends of ours. Yeah, I was pretty disappointed when I came out, but I think it's one of these things where it's hard to match how good the first one was because we were not expecting it, didn't realise how good it would be, and it hit so well. But it was always going to be bought. The second one is always bought, so I'm curious about the third. But yeah, I still feel pretty much the same as I did back then. It's still a pretty disappointing film.
Yeah, I remember as well at the time, I think I had opening night ticket. No, I had tickets booked for the Saturday, and I think I'd booked the day after to go with my dad as well, because he loves the first Guardians film. And the reason I remember watching it for the first time isn't actually because of the film. I'm not much into boxing, but it was Anthony Joshua versus Klitschko. And I remember at the cinema, my IMAX is, if anyone's been, I don't think you'd have been to it, but it's in Birmingham. It's at Resort World. That's where I normally go. And there's a casino, kind of like the Empire in Leicester Square. There's a casino right next to the cinema.
Right.
And as the film finished, I went on my phone and it was the end of the boxing as you're waiting on the credit scene. So then when these hundreds of people start walking out the cinema screen, the fight finishes and you've suddenly got hundreds of people coming out of a casino. And it was ridiculous. Wait to get out of the building. I've been very careful since to make sure there's no boxing on again whilst that happens. Completely irrelevant to the channel. Probably the only time we'll ever speak about boxing that's not a Rocky film. However, Stallone is in this film, which is something I'm very excited to talk about. I remember it purely for being stuck in traffic after, and I didn't mind it. My problem is that Chris would say this with it. I have really bad recent bias where I tend to get really like sucked in after I watch a film for the first time. and it can lead me to have some pretty wild accusations. And I really enjoyed it, but I knew straight away this isn't Guardians 1. I mean, Guardians 1, Neil, what you said, it was, to me, it was lightning in a bottle. It shouldn't have worked, but it did, and it proved so much. And I think the second one had so much expectation because it was following that up, because they hadn't been in Ultron yet, and there was loads of variables to come into it. And rewatching it again, say the first time since that second screening, I still enjoy it. I still think there's some really great stuff. And I think this is so much better than I thought. Then you'll just get something that's like, and it sort of drags it down a bit. But I still had a lot of fun with it. I'm intrigued to see where I'd rank it amongst the MCU when the final bell's been rung, not to quote Lex Luthor. However, that being said, we always talk about what they introduced to the MCU. And quite frankly, being polite, this one really doesn't. It doesn't bring necessarily a big new character or storyline. You know, this is the first one had Thanos in and had an Infinity Stone, and this one was very much that personal journey for Peter Quill, which I really enjoy that stuff. But in terms of a grand scope, I don't think it has much there. However, what did it bring in mind is that Eternals is going to come out later this year. And I wonder with the whole celestial being stuff, if they were to mention Kurt Russell, but I kind of had the influence of I'm curious to know more about the Eternals type stuff, because they are kind of tied into it, aren't they? So that was something that rung through my mind, but I'm just going to ask it to you guys. Is there anything major you think this one did, or is it so self-contained that it sticks within that, which is quite rare for a Marvel film?
I think it introduces Mantis as sort of one of the new characters, and she sort of comes in and becomes a Guardian of the Galaxy by the end, is main character, like she appears in Infinity War and Endgame. But other than her, there isn't a whole lot that it adds to it, really. It doesn't connect too much and bring anything new to the MCU, I think.
Yeah, I pretty much agree. Mantis is the only thing that it introduces, and everything else is fairly forgettable, to be honest. I think it's a good look at his relationship with his father, but as soon as he trailer, you kind of knew he was going to be the bad guy anyway. I mean, there was no getting around that. But no, nothing major, which I think is a shame, but I don't think all these films need to bring something that major. I think if it's a good story told well, then fine. I mean, this wasn't, but still.
No, exactly. I think good both sides with Mantis. Pom, can everyone say Pom Clementife? I think it's pronounced.
Yes.
I remember the trailers coming out, and I was kind of there like, okay, you've got some new comic relief. They kept showing Batista. First time I saw this one, I really didn't like her. I don't know why. And then I kind of really enjoyed her on the rewatches, and when I've had moments with her in Infinity War as well. And I quite like, I think for the guys, the Galaxy, you know, they're misfits, they're idiots, but they are there with one of them. I think she's a really good fit into their group. And I'm glad they didn't try and expand the group by three or four people or make it this big aura, whereas it still feels like the same core with like one or two extra people coming in. But I think she's great in it. She's one of the most interesting stuff. And a lot of the comic relief comes from her and Batista, who to me are just an amazing double act.
Yeah, the two of them are very funny. Like, there's that bit when you first learn of her powers and she's sort of reading them, and then drags soul to me. This is the funniest thing I've ever seen. Yeah, they're quite funny together. But I do think she feels like one of the lesser Guardians in terms of her role. Like, she doesn't get as much time, particularly in sort of some of the other films as well, like in Infinity War. And then in this one, even though, because she was sort of joining the team, then she's not a full Guardian at the start of the film, obviously, but then as she goes on, she just doesn't quite feel like as big a Guardian as some of the other ones, which makes sense because she wasn't in the first film, but she still feels like a smaller role, even though she's sort of joining the team. And so she feels a bit lesser, I think.
I'm not a fan of all the moments between her and Drax. I found them quite forced and annoying. It was just, they're just sitting there laughing at their own jokes, and I found them just really bloody irritating, to be honest, after a while. And it just more and more forced as the film went on. And it's just like, just shut up. There's a very good bond between them, because they are both, they're more misfits within this group of misfits than the others. And I think they show how good they can be in Infinity War, because there is a couple of good lines between them. But in this, it just, Oh God, it's insufferable. I found it far too annoying after a while. And they push Drax to be even funnier by doing the thing that some sequels do by amplifying the personality trait that that he had in the first film that people found funny. And he's just taking things literally and laughing at things that aren't necessarily funny or not realizing that things are funny. Yeah, so that was annoying as well. So yeah, I wasn't a massive fan of that. I think that was one of the biggest down points.
No, that's a good point, because with Drax as well, I think a lot of people have said that you get, because for me, you know, I grew up watching wrestling, and Batista was one of the main ones. So seeing Batista jump into film for me was really fun, and I've loved seeing him in films over the years. And in that first one, I didn't for one ever day think he'd have that comedy within him. And I think you are right. It's that, I don't want to say comedy sequel because it's not an outright comedy, but it's very much in a sequel you'll have. We're going to do the jokes, and he said amplify it. And I think Drax does suffer from that. He's still my favorite, but I think the moment you get the opening scene of him jumping inside the monster, the quietest stuff, I like it. But then, and then the next scene, it's him dangling off the ship again, and then it's him again. And we do get a lot more of him. And I would say that's really cool in Infinity War, is that I think some of his best humor is actually in Infinity War, aside from the first film.
Yeah.
Because I think, not that they're all under a blur. Do you guys ever get this in Marvel films where just sometimes you forget what film, what film you've seen, but was it when they were in this film or was it when they're in this film? And the Invisible Batista, was that for me? And I kind of thought, like, oh, it wasn't in this one. And I guess that's a credit to the Russo brothers, because I know that James Gunn obviously helped out with some of their script writing stuff, but if in terms of a jump up to Infinity War, Russo brothers handled them exactly how you would feel they would. Didn't feel like different directors were writing them or playing with them, telling them what to do. It felt so natural, which is a bonus for them. But we're not talking Infinity War, which is a shame. Not very soon, though. Give us a couple of weeks. I also, actually, no, Jed, sorry, apologies. Have you got anything on Drax as well with that?
I'll just sort of echo what you've both already said. I think they make him much stupider in this one, and sort of they make him the butt of more jokes. And I think it's quite funny, but it's not quite what it was in the first film, and they just take it a bit too far, I think.
Yeah, it's that quite literal where they go with that humour too extreme with it. What I would say, with someone else that does come back, that is a, I guess, a guy in the galaxy coming into the film, we get Nebula, which is, to me, one of the best things in the film. In the first one, was like, oh, okay, just generic, you know, henchman, got a personal issue with the sister. And then after this one, I felt that Nebula's a great character. Now, in our last video, Theo said that she is his favourite Guardian because of this film. I think she's got the best character arc of all of them, except Yondu. And I think when you get maybe at the point of the process where they know that she's going to have a big role in Endgame, which is why they want to do stuff with her journey in this one. But I thought Karen Gillan, from what we got of her in this, was great, but it was definitely a lot better than that first one.
Yeah, I agree that it's definitely a lot better, but I think it is mainly because of where her character goes in Endgame. It's like she has to make that transition from where she was in the first Guardians film, where she needs to be in Endgame. So they use this film really well to make that transition, and so that she sort of starts changing, her arc starts to come together a bit more in this one. And I think that's really good. I think they did that really well.
Yeah, it was fine. I I'm not sort of a huge fan of this sort of aspect. I think she was good in it. I think she's given more to do, which was great. And they did need to position her in a place of not being on Thanos' side anymore, and sort of like essentially changing allegiance, which they did, but I don't think they did that great. They had sort of more stuff with her sister, which also I didn't care about. I don't want to see more of those two. Like, yeah, it'll be interesting if they did it over a few months, rather than just like shoving it all into one film and giving them a close relationship. I'm glad they gave them more to do. I just don't think it worked all that well.
Yeah, that's fair enough. It's a weird one, because I think it is right. It is that Endgame stuff, isn't it? Where it is very much, we've got a plan for her. There's going to, because they were writing Endgame, what, in 20? They started writing it in like, well, 2016 time. So it would have been around the time maybe this script was being written, and they'd have had stuff in mind with what they want to do. So I wonder if there was very much, this is the game plan, can you do this with it? Because aside from Nebula, they don't really set up the Avengers storyline, which I'm absolutely fine with, going for what you said earlier, Neil. It doesn't need to be that connected to all of them. And I think when you realize this was set straight after the first one, we have Baby Groot, which is probably, to me, one of my favorite additions to the MCU. I was kind of worried when I first saw it in the trailers, but after the opening scene, I don't think you can add anything else about it. It's one of my favorite credit sequences in the Marvel stuff. And well, it's also a great song, isn't it? I mean, we'll speak about the soundtrack in a bit, because the Guardians of the Galaxy, the soundtrack is another character among them. It's got that mindset. And I think when this one came out, you were going into like, what songs are they going to pick this time? But we'll get to that shortly. I want to mention, let's not save Quill to the end, because I don't actually like this. Ego the Living Planet, Kurt Russell. We get him as the villain, right? And now I love Kurt Russell. I've not seen him in many things, but he has so much charisma in everything he does. I was really not, I don't want to say disappointed by him. It's what you said, Neil, that you kind of knew something wasn't right the moment you, I guess, you start watching the film, where it's like, it's all a bit, even aside from the opening scene, even the scenes, everyone's like, it's all going far too well with the father-son dynamic. And what I will say about James Gunn, he writes it in better that the supporting characters clock it quicker. And I think it's that naivety with Peter Quill, that he's not had the father figure, so he's more than happy to absorb into it. And that is quite a real scenario too. So when you get the twist, you know, what I don't like is the whole, and that's why I put the tumor in her head. It's really, you know, it's not wrong to say that he's the villain, but it just felt a bit, not too much, a bit like, how do you make someone evil and then you have to strip it down to like, I'm going to give them cancer? I never liked the tumor line. It felt out of place. And it felt as if that if they wanted to have killed the mom or had him do something, I just felt there was something else they could have done with it. It was just, the delivery of it feels so strange.
I really like that tumor bit. I think because that's the moment when Quill realizes that he's evil. And I think that's a really crucial moment because of his relationship that he had with his mum. I think it was really good, that whole scene. But in terms of Ego as a villain, I don't think he's very good at all. Like, and the twist of him being evil, like, I just clocked he was a villain straight away. I remember watching the film, so I knew he was the villain. And then a few months later, I saw someone online, like, I was talking to someone about it, and they were like, oh, I really liked the twist. And I just stopped for a second. I was like, hang on, there was a twist in that film. What was the twist? And they were like, Ego. And I was like, was that meant to be a twist? Like, I just saw him as a villain straight away. It didn't even strike me as a twist at all. Like, that's how bad it was, I thought. And I really don't think he's a great villain. But the twist aside, I think he's not one of the worst MCU villains, but it's really not a twist at all.
Yeah, I completely agree. Like I said, I think that a lot of people assumed he'd be the villain in the trailer. And it's just like, it's, and then in the end he was, and that's partly because there was no other villain that there could have been. It could have been Yondu again, or, you know, they could have made him to a bad guy, but they didn't. But it got to a point in the film where you realised no one else it could be. So it was going to be him. The line about the tumour, I thought was quite well done. I must admit, that's one of the few quite liked about this film, which makes me seem really deranged saying I like a tumor, but you know, it was I remember the audible gasp from watching in the cinema, and I definitely gasped myself. I thought that was well done. As a villain, yeah, he's bored. It's kind of standard Marvel villain, wants to take over the world and the universe and everything else. So it's nothing new. So yeah, I think they could have done something a lot better with him.
Yeah, it's the trueness of it. I think it's more for me, because I don't mind the fact he killed them. This sounds really horrible. It's like that. How do you make him the villain? And I think because we know it's going to happen, I think that's why it's harder. I love Quill's reaction. Is going to be suggested the fact he sort of guns him down straight away. You know, his eyes go back to normal. I loved that dynamic with him. And but it was, you know, the discovery of all the bodies, and you know that something was brewing, that, you know, when Yondu, you know, they're obviously teasing the fact that he didn't take him to his father, there was something else going on. And I think once you get the twist, I think the actual villain itself, yeah, he's, to bring in Kurt Russell, And it's sort of, that's what you get from him. It's a real shame, because I will say this about Marvel is that, you know, they've had a villain problem. We've said it quite a lot. I think the next batch of films is probably the best streak of villains we get in a long time. What we've got coming up next, we've got what, Vulture, I really love Hela. We've got some really good ones coming, Killmonger.
Yeah.
And there's so much. And then this was like such a shame. And then again, you know, he's literally a living planet. Like, how do you sort of do that? And I like the fact there's like he's got a human interpretation. I love the whole little museum-y stuff they did, but you know, when you get to the ending, his character, you don't really care. Like, you kind of know he's going to have to die straight away, and the Guardians are going to move on. But I think what allowed that to do is, to me, my favorite whole part of this film is the Yondu arc, which I absolutely love. I think Michael Rooker is amazing as Yondu. We have so much fun. Because he's not in the first one all that much. We get some good scenes in him, but you kind of finish the film, okay, I want to know more about him. And I think he'd had that effect where everyone loved him, and what do they want to do? And you can tell that I think James Gunn had a lot of fun writing him, because we get his whole backstory, we get current story, and we get a final completion of his act too. And I thought that the Yondu stuff was, to me, the standout. Again, on the rewatch as well, you can, not horribly, but I know that James Gunn put a lot of hope into everyone, but I think you can tell that they're having the most fun with the Yondu stuff.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yondu's arc is definitely the best thing about this film. It's so good. And then at the end, it's sad when he dies. But I think it's really well done, sort of the way, because like you said, he wasn't in the first one a huge amount. He's sort of there. And then as this film comes about, you learn a bit more about him. And then as the film goes on, you learn more and more until his arc is really complete by the end. And he's just such a great character, and his transition and his relationship with Quill, I think, is really well done in this film.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think the first time you see him in this, he's looking he's looking up into the distance by his like ravages there, and he's clearly thinking about what to do next. And he looks like he's got a lot of regrets, which he seems to go through in this film. Like, there's a really, really good scene with him and Rocket, like, saying they're the same person and saying how similar they are. And I thought it was brilliant. Really, really well done. The writing was so good. Rocket is just fantastic. I've liked him since, what was it? Walking Dead. He was great in that. And, yeah, I definitely want to see more of him as an actor. I've not seen enough. But, yeah, he was fantastic in this.
Yeah, because I've never seen Walking Dead, but all my friends used to say, is it Merle he plays? I used to get always quoted by his name and how they'd say it. But it's really interesting to listen. I think what I love is, you know, bringing in, I'm going to have to say it's Stallone, a fan favourite to our channel. I remember the first time I saw it, I says, wait, what? Stallone's in this film? Like, he looked amazing. I mean, I absolutely love Rocky. I love Stallone. He just seems, sort of, well, in his older, he just seems like a really nice guy compared to when he was younger. And it's when we did a Rocky review series last year. We did all of them, but when Rocky, it's so hard not to diss himself. When Stallone's ever in character, you can always tell it's like Shakespeare to him. Even though I know this is a comedy and he's taking it seriously, it's a dramatic role, it always feels like he's giving it like 200% for every take. And it's when he's, I mean, for a start, his amazing costume, like the orange wires, like if you're kind of wanting a Stallone sort of, they are literally Ravagers, but if you wanted that sort of scavenger space scum thing, he looked like the real deal there. Like, it looked like Cobra in space. And when he popped up, I was like, whoa, I was like, okay, this is a big name. And then you're getting backstory to Yondu. You're finding out that he was taking kids, which we knew about, and it was against the code. And it was like John Wick. I was like, oh, I want to know more about the Ravagers' little inside world. Now, like, what else don't we know? I think when you can clearly tell, going for Easter, Neil, that Yondu's got all this regret, got these issues, and the fact they won't have anything to do with him, I think that's when you know, okay, this is going to be quite a personal journey for him. And I loved not just getting to, I just love seeing the Ravagers. And also, I think the best villain of this film is Taserface by A Country Mile, purely because of the laughs. That first screening, when he declared himself Taserface to the world, that, it's one of them ridiculous, stupid things that is so funny and so well done. The only character you actually want around him is Rocket that can give that away. And the whole, you know, murdering all the other Ravagers is really dark and depressing too. But every moment is satisfying across that character arc. But what I'll add to that, before I pass over is that you get these films, and I'm not going to say Last Jedi's one because I love Last Jedi, but you know when they do something that's this big reveal that you've built up for a while, it's the hyperspace jump in that film where you've got this intrigue about what's going to be this big thing, and then how does the next one follow up? To me, Yondu has, I can't whistle, so I can't do it, but Yondu's got his arrow. And if you look at the first one, they build up the arrow maneuver so well. We get it for one glimpse, a couple of seconds at the end, and it becomes that, not that boring theory stuff, but it's like, okay, we can't just have him do that in every scene because it lessens seeing it. You don't want to see something like overused, and bringing in that scavenger stuff, you know, going for the heads, make sure he can't use it. It builds up to the escape so well because you know he'd be able to destroy them with the arrow if he really felt like it. And I think everything of Yondu was just so well written by James Gunn and performed by them. And that sub story just really makes the film for me.
Yeah, I think the one problem with Sylvester Stallone's role in it is that you sort of want to see more of him. And I don't know, is he coming back for the third one? I don't know, but it would be nice just to see more. Oh, that's good then. I'm pleased because I like him. And like you said, it's Stallone. Like, you want to see more of him. And so I hope we see him again because it's only one or two scenes that we really get him in, which is a bit of a shame.
Yeah, he's was he in a couple of scenes? Was he at the beginning?
Yeah. He's at the bar.
Because I remember at the end of the funeral. Oh, right. Okay, yeah. Yeah, definitely want to see more. I'm sure I've read that he's coming back. But so that'll be cool. I think because there was a shot or there was like several shots and each shot had like a original Guardians of the Galaxy member from like the comics, and I think he was like in one of those shots, so that was really cool. I love that. The stuff of the Ravagers, I would love to see more of that. That is really interesting. I think when we saw them all come together at the end for Yondu, that was fascinating. There's such an incredible rich backstory there. I think there would be a good Disney Plus TV series there, I think. Yeah, I definitely want to see more of that, and I hope Stallone is coming back for more.
Yeah, speaking of the Disney Plus series, I'm going to use this to plug another video. We did 15 Marvel shows we want to see, and that was on my list of five. I want, because they're all set up in the credit scene, and I believe that they originally, James Gunn was in talks with David Bowie to be one of them. Couldn't tell you which one, but part of his plans was originally having Bowie, which would have been phenomenal, and I think that would have probably definitely happened. Obviously it didn't for obvious reasons, but there's, as you said, there's so much backstory, and you don't want to know everything about every Marvel film, about every character in their life, but you see something and say there's just something to tell here, and there's something really intriguing about them all, and it's Stallone. And I think him and James Gunn have built a really good relationship that he's now going to be in the Suicide Squad as well, and I'm kind of there like, I mean, he obviously probably won't be fighting in the Suicide Squad because he should win it. But I'm just kind of, they've obviously built a relationship, and I'd be shocked if he isn't in that third one. Now, I know it's going to film in London this year, so does it come down to something as petty as Slane being willing to fly to London for filming? I really hope so. But either way, there's some really good stuff. And yeah, just sort of final thing for me on the Yondu stuff, it's just the whole funeral scene, like even from a visual standpoint, it just feels, you know, Marvel has, I hate saying this, Marvel's got a problem with death. They'd like to bring back characters, and even as far as this week, James Gunn is once again reaffirming to everyone, Yondu will not be coming back. It's a pivotal moment, and what the scene does, you know, the whole Mary Poppins stuff, what I think is the heart of this is that Yondu is the father for Quill, and you get that really nice sort of really quick flashbacks to him with him growing up, and I think that is the realization for Quill, that was the father figure to his life. And I think that's what the acceptance is that he did have someone all along. And I think James Gunn weave that in quite neatly to the story too.
Now, just going back to sort of the idea about death, and Marvel always seemed to bring them back. I remember at the time he was seen on the set of Infinity War. And I remember when it came out, they were like, oh no, he's staying dead. That was sort of just a trick. So you didn't realize he died. And I thought that was quite good. You didn't expect him to die then. And then when it happened, you think, oh, are they bringing him back in Infinity War? And then when they're like, no, that was just a bit of a ruse. It's like, oh, that's quite good then.
Yeah, his death was well done. Glad it stuck as well. And it's a really good emotional moment, and it's one of these things that I think it'll hit you either way. Like, I've obviously had a recent passing away of my father, so it's one of those things that even before that happened, I still had a very emotional reaction to that watching the film before that happened, and even more so now. I think it's done really, really well, and I don't think I saw it coming, like him being like the father figure to Quill until it was laid out in front of me. But yeah, I thought that was done really well. I think I heard a really good interview with Gunn a while ago, and he got quite emotional about not being able to work with Michael Rooker again on this film, or on these on the Guardians films at least. And it says a lot about how much he cares about his cast and how much he loves working with Rooker. I don't know if he has that bond with anyone else, but it's just really interesting.
Yeah, I think the James Gunn stuff, you know, obviously I think it's worth bringing up what happened after the film with the old tweets, the old photos, the old jokes, and then obviously Disney sacked him, the keyword Disney, not Marvel, because from what I understand, Marvel was always aware and it had been dealt with internally many years before. Mm-hmm. But Disney needed to make a statement, and from that statement, we then get him directing Suicide Squad, which I absolutely love the concept of. That's one of my most anticipated films of the year, just because, you know, there's a character called Polka Dot Man, for God's sake, and you just know he's going to massacre half of them at the click of a finger. And I'm so excited to see James Gunn not do something else, but off the back of all this, I'm not going to get into a cancel culture sort of debacle. I'm very for it when it's the right person. People keep making out it's a bad thing when you cancel racists. It's not. The stuff with this is that, obviously, I'm not going to get into the context of the jokes and stuff, but the fact from day one, that cast was with him. Kevin Feige was with him. They were all with him. And sometimes I understand why Disney's a company might want to associate themselves with something else and distance themselves from him, but at the same time, it makes me a hypocrite for what I've said about others in the past, that you know, if it's been dealt with many years ago, just move on, because it was dealt with many years before. It was almost like a public execution for no reason, and no sane director would have took over this film out of respect for him. I know that sounds really strange, because someone would have been like, yeah, I'll do Guardians, but that cast, it's what you said, they feel like a family, and you see any interviews with them, they absolutely adore just being on set with one another, and you can really see it when they're on there. And I don't want to get into sort of hearsay rumors and stuff as well, but you know, there was a very obvious thing was that Sean Gunn obviously motion captured Rocket in all the films he's been in, and I believe if you believe the rumors, he was told he would be voicing him too, and obviously that was took away from him and went to Bradley Cooper. And then what do we get in this film? We get him in a much bigger role, and not here to sit here and spread things, but I can imagine there was a lot of truth to that, and I think that's why we got him in an expanded role, because it goes down to that whole motion capture sort of agreement that, you know, you want to be able to sort of see him, and the fact he would have motion captured him and voiced him would have been quite nice. But at the same time, I understand why I couldn't write Marvel, who are bankrolling a film about a talking tree and raccoon, would have wanted some A-listers in Vin Diesel, Bradley Cooper. So, you know, I can't really fault that, but as a group, as a characters, and even when they rocked up again in Infinity War and Endgame, they just feel like their own entity. And that's what I think the enjoyment is, that you're not necessarily watching the film for the villain, for the CGI, for all that stuff. You're watching them because you like these characters and you just want to see what the game's like. I think that's why we're getting a holiday special from them too. If any Marvel series was not going to get, you know, like a series, but we're getting a holiday special, you know that it's going to be amazing. It's going to be ridiculous. And it's going to work because it's the Guardians of the Galaxy. So sort of looking forward, I'm so excited that, you know, Disney, you know, sorted themselves out, patched it up with James Gunn, because he's clearly had an idea in mind for the third film, and didn't even say they didn't even need to change any writing. They just simply delayed when it was meant to be filmed to end of this year, where it's going to start filming now. So that whole sort of politics aside from it, I'm excited something's made, because they deserve more as well. They're just, and I really hope the third one can be different and can be better than this.
Yeah, like with the tweets and that, I see why Disney got rid of him at the time. And now I think after that sort of all blew over and people kind of didn't forget about it, but it sort of got lost a bit more and it wasn't on everyone's mind as much. And then they rehired him. I think that was a really good decision, because like you said, he is definitely the best person to direct these films. And it seems so natural, everything, and the relationship between them all. and the characters are just so good, and that is what works about these films. Like when the first one came out and you've got a film about a talking tree and a talking raccoon, all these people, like, you don't think it's going to work at all, but then the characters are just so great and they all work so well together. And when they're all in the same place, it does work really well, and the holiday special is going to be quite fun to watch because the characters are just so great and enjoyable, and you just have a great time watching them every time you see them.
I thought Firing was hypocritical of Disney because they kind of kept on other people who were even more problematic. So that annoyed me. I could not believe it when I read it. It was really shocking. I read the tweets and yeah, they're horrible. But if they knew about them at the time, if Marvel did, then I don't see why it's suddenly a problem now just because some right wing nonsensical publication, website, what have you, bug them just to embarrass him. And it's one of these things that, you know, the right wing don't like people who say like these sorts of things, but they say all sorts of horrible things themselves. So there's hypocrites all over the place. So it was really frustrating. It was incredible to see them band together, and they wrote that letter, excuse me, which they all signed and released to the media. And that was incredible, like fantastic. And I remember Dave Bautista says that he will do it, but only if they keep his script and not change anything and what have you. And I think a lot of people wanted Taika Waititi to take over because I think he would have been a good fit. But it's good came back, and I think they made the wrong decision and realized it a bit too late. But at least he's come back now.
Yeah, I think Taika's a great point, because I actually wanted to add to that was that the only director who I could imagine right now taking on the property and doing something not good with it, but having the respect of maybe the actors or James Gunn's blessing, is Taika. And obviously we're kind of getting I keep calling them the Guardians of the Galaxy. We know they're going to pop up in Thor 4 for how long, none of us know yet, but we know that they filmed on it. We know Endgame set that storyline up, and maybe Thor will join them at the end of the film. Who knows? I doubt it for whatever reason, but yeah, it's the whole debacle was ridiculous. And kind of, I hate using this as a blessing to talk about the films, the fact it was patched up before Infinity War and Endgame came out meant that the entire press tour of those two films wasn't so, are we going to talk about James Gunn? Are we going to talk about this? And I'm glad it was, you know, it was done, it was dusted, and as you know, everyone's moved on. And it's just, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, as great as the internet can be, for every probably two great things, I'd say there's probably four shite things that's happening now. And it was clearly never intended for that. To the psychos. Actually, I'm going to say really quickly, the time of recording this, Zack Snyder destroyed the Gamers and Geeks this week. Probably the highlight of social media for the last month for me. And I'm going to just quickly move on before I share that around, because they're going to come for me now and claim that Lucasfilm hired a PR agent to make me say this because it's still Kathleen Kennedy's fault, even though it's Warner Brothers. So, let's talk the soundtrack, because these, you know, the awesome mix of Volume 2, I was very excited. I think I remember after the first one came out, James Gunn was sharing songs. It's like, this was so close to making the cut and I just couldn't use this. And I love hearing his process of these scenes and how he brings the songs into it. So naturally the second one was, is he just going to use all the songs he didn't want to use on the first one? And I'm so glad it wasn't. Some of these songs, once more, have a lot of meaning. Going back to that scene of Yondu, probably one of the most powerful moments of the film is down to the song they play during that scene. But I love the soundtrack. I don't want to compare it to the first one, because this one feels, I mean, they're just a compilation of great songs. I don't like the comparisons, but as a Formula One fan, having The Chain by Fleetwood Mac on it was probably one of the best things I'd heard. And you know as well that they definitely didn't play the 30 seconds used in F1, because everyone would have thought of F1. So that was one of my highlights. But I just want to hand over, do you have any like favorite songs from the soundtrack for this one?
I think definitely I like the first song, Mr. Blue Sky with Groot, just because the scene is so good. I think it works so well and it's such a great scene. But just one thing that really bugs me about the soundtrack is The Chain with Fleetwood Mac. They use it twice in the film, which really bugs me. I don't know why it bugs me as much as it does, but it's like, just play it once and use a different song the other time. It's like, there are so many great songs in the soundtrack of both films, and it's like, you choose the same song twice. Like, do they really need to do that? But otherwise, the soundtrack's really good.
Yeah, I find it weird when a film quite big and got loads of songs uses a song twice, because I think there's a few films when they do it and people say, oh, it's so brave to do that. No, it's not. It's just annoying. I think Mr. Blue Sky is definitely one of the best. I think Yondu's funeral. Oh, what is it they play? I've got it in my head and I'm not going to sing it.
I'm going to find
that song. I think it's called like, I think it might be called Father and Son, funnily enough, which may have had me in tears.
Yeah. Father and Son by Cat Stevens. One of the most powerful moments from
that. That's great. Yeah, exactly. I think it's like a perfect song for that moment. Yeah, it's a great soundtrack. I think you're right. I think you're right not to compare it to the first film, because they are kind of, as you say, the characters on their own, so they are different characters. And I think James Gunn uses music really, really well. And I think he normally releases the soundtrack, or at least the track listings, before the film's out, which is, I think, quite a cool thing to do.
Yeah, and I think that was a big thing, that was released early. I've got the cassette tapes actually behind me. Still ridiculous to track them down. Then everyone wants to buy the Walkman. I think they're like 800 quid on eBay. Probably thanks for being blue and from Guardians of the Galaxy. So I won't be buying one of them ever. But you just know that, or you can imagine going back to 2014, that all these cosplayers, like overnight, like freeze framing at the cinema, like what Walkman spec was that? How do I find out what a Walkman is? And all the people that catch from the sort of 70s, 80s are probably like buzzing, like, here we go, business is back. But I love the score. And even Brian Tyler's score, I don't think it was as good as the first one, the actual orchestral score. But politely put, the Guardians have a great theme, but you're not really watching this film for the orchestral score. You're watching this film for the songs that get used in it, and kind of Infinity Jed as well. When the chain rocks up twice, the second time, as they're like, I know you've kind of got it in sync with them punching each other, but you literally used it earlier for better reason. So why not get another song out there?
Yeah, and one thing I found out, actually, it was only the other day I discovered that when they were making this, James Gunn met with Edgar Wright to discuss the soundtracks and make sure there weren't any clashes between this and Baby Driver, because that was coming out similar sort of time, which I thought was quite interesting that they didn't want any of the same songs and the same soundtracks, which is quite a good point, because if you hear one song and then a few weeks later you go see the other film, it's like, oh, that's the same song, it wouldn't feel as good. So I think that was quite good that the two met, and yeah, and so the soundtrack could be as good as it was.
I like the orchestral stuff in this, I must say. I think I agree, you don't really watch it for that, but there are some MCU heroes who have really, really good scores and themes, I should say, and the Guardians is definitely one of the best. It's so good and it's so recognizable. I think they use it twice in this film that I can remember. I don't think they use it a third time, but like they use it fairly sparingly in a 2 hour 15 minute film, so I like it. But I get that. I think it's not one of the best, but it's really good.
Yeah, and I think their theme for themselves works so well, but it does feel, I hate using them as Star Wars-y, but it feels like this is a kind of space soundtrack, but quite heroic at the same time. And it'd be so easy for them to just do a version of the Avengers score. Like, if you look at, the new Justice League, but a lot of Hans Zimmer tracks, I'd say, and he's my favourite composer, you can find a lot of crossovers in between his work. And I love most of his work, but you get like, aha, I've heard this before, and now it's being used for somebody else. And I'm glad that Guardians don't have that effect, that it sounds like the Avengers theme done differently. It feels like they're their own thing. So the score is a really good thing to bring up. I don't know if anyone else has got anything to add on the score. If not, we can talk about... I mean, I'm going to merge the credit scenes with the Stanley cameo because it's absolutely fair for this, but does anyone else need to say anything about the score, or shall we move on to 1 of 5?
let's move on, I think.
Yeah. Five credit scenes. Let's take the credit scenes even out of the equation. We've got Jeff Goldblum dancing during the credits, which was the ultimate sign of what was to come in Thor Ragnarok. I remember watching, I was like, wait, what? Jeff Goldblum's not been in this film, he's in the next one. So that's like a meta reference. And it's just James Gunn being James Gunn. Like, I can imagine Taika Waititi on set filming Thor, ringing James Gunn like, hey, Jeff Goldblum's like in prime Jeff Goldblum right now. do you need him for anything in Guardians? And you could just imagine James Gunn like, I'm just going to have everyone dancing during the credits. Do you reckon he can do something? And the day we find out what that phone call was, I'm going to absolutely love it. But as far as a polite setup for Ragnarok, I love that. And it's technically not really a credit scene.
Yeah, it isn't really a credit scene, but it's still nice just to see him there dancing along with everyone else. anything with the costume that is going to be good fun. Like his character in Ragnarok is so much fun. So to see him here is a nice little tease because you know that he's going to be in the next one because it was only a few months away, Ragnarok. And it's like, oh, yeah. And the song Guardians Inferno that they play in the credits is really great as well with David Hasselhoff. I really like that.
Yeah, the more Goldblum, the better, I say. You can't have enough. He's always great. And not just acting, dancing is wonderful. So, yeah, big fan.
Guardians Inferno as well, one of the greatest songs in Marvel. I remember watching, I was like, is this a new song? Like, it feels like they're talking about the Guardians of the Galaxy. And I was like, I know it's really stupid of me now because we know it was written for the film, but at the time, I was kind of there like, because I'm rubbish with music, so like I'd use these films to find out new songs. And I was like, wow, like they did really well to find a song about someone talking about a tree and bad parentage. And then you realize it's also David Hasselhoff. You're like, oh, okay, they actually made it for this film. But they also made one of the best ever music videos I've ever seen for this film as well. If you've not seen it, check out the Guardians Inferno music video, because that was also incredible.
Yeah, it's great fun. I just love the end of the song when it's like, just remember, we are great. It's like a great way to end the song when you're there waiting for the final post-credit scene and then that's coming up and it's like, oh yeah, this is great.
That is really, really good. I didn't know there was a music video to it. I don't think I've seen that. I'll have to check it out. I will check it out before dinner tonight. I'll do that later.
Yeah, I'm not going to spoil it for you. Unreal music video. I sent you straight after. Let's actually go into. I mean, I've not got anything to say about the Kraglin. I mean, there's five of them, right? So I'm some of these I think of the conversation. Some of it. Kraglin, that's just like a fun second or two. It's got Batista being at the punchline again, and I don't know if Master saying it. I wonder if he'll be in the third film. He didn't crop up in Infinity War and Endgame, so I would like Kraglin to pop up because. I like Sean Gunn's character in it. I think he adds a lot of... He is that weird guy. And even at the funeral scene, one of my favourite moments was him, like, screaming and being all excited because the Ravagers, you know, they were with him and I liked him in it. The credit scene, yeah. If he's going to have the thing, the whistle, that's going to look really strange, I'm not going to lie, on him. I'm not going to be racist. It's not because he's not blue. But I don't know. I just can't see anyone else wearing it.
Yeah, it definitely doesn't look right on him in that scene. And I hope he doesn't continue to wear that if he does come back. But I think he should return in the next film, hopefully. Like, because he's now, especially if they continue more with the Ravagers, we've all said we want to see more about them. And so I think he's sort of going to take over Yondu's role as sort of one of the lead Ravagers. So if they set him up for that kind of... So I think it's important that he comes back. But that scene is just a funny... sort of short moment, and it's not really like the credits hadn't started by that point, had they? It's just the title comes up. And then, so is it really a post-credit scene if the credits haven't started, or is that just the end of the film?
it's fine. I remember hearing like there were five or six before watching this film, and it was just like, what are they setting up? I was like, in the end, they're kind of setting up like pretty much nothing, except for I think maybe one of them. But this one was fine. It was fun. It was quite nice to see, and it was good to sort of see him use that weapon. And just hearing Drax scream was very funny. If that was worth it, I suppose.
Yeah. No. Exactly. And I think again, it's that fun one at the first one. It's just Batista's got comic timing I never knew he'd have. And yet now we've seen him in dramas like Blade Runner as well. So really fascinating to see how he's going to sort of further develop, because to me, he'll always be, the Batista bomb, the Great Khali, all that beautiful stuff back in the late noughties. Less wrestling, though. Let's go to Stallone. We mentioned Stallone already, but I did not know that was Ving Rhames until today. That really blew my mind that Ving Rhames is one of the Ravagers, and I think James Gunn had been tweeting this week, actually. They were talking and saying, how did you get Miley Cyrus on it? Because she's the voice box. And he was saying, it's simple. I just asked them, and they say, yes, they want to be in Guardians of the Galaxy. What a way. I love this team. I don't know if we'll get a delivery on it. Was it a nod to the comics, as we said earlier? I don't know. But I would love for them to pop up, even if it's for a scene in the new one. It's just that world-building type stuff that, you know, there's a history to it all, and I'd like to see them also just be badasses. It's not an important scene, but it is that really nice tease of, you know, if he wanted to follow that up, he could.
Yeah, I think the thing is, if they come back, it'll make that scene make a bit more sense and it'll be more meaningful. But in the cinema, watching that, it didn't feel anything special. Like, when you don't, it's not until you get home that you realise, oh, that was Miley Cyrus, that was Ving Rhames. You sort of realise who they were, who they are, and then sort of, I've never read any of your comics, so I don't know who those characters are. It's only when you get home, you start Googling Guardians of the Galaxy post-credit scene explained, that you start realising what was going on. And so seeing it in the cinema, sort of a bit naff, it didn't really do anything for me. I think it's only when you've seen it again and you sort of know who they are, and hopefully if they're setting something up with that and something happens in the next film, hopefully it'll mean a bit more. So yeah, it didn't mean too much to me.
Yeah, I'm the same. I love seeing these guys on screen anyway. I enjoy Ving Rhames in the Mission Impossible films and other things that he's been. But in this, it was fine. But yeah, again, I didn't realise that was, as far as I'm aware, like the original Guardians shot. And yeah, it was good. It was nice to see, but nothing significant, I don't think.
No, definitely. But I think there is one significant one, brackets we think. The tease of Adam Warlock. I don't know if you guys can remember, cast your mind back to the not so long ago, 2017, and oh my god, Adam Warlock's going to destroy Thanos. It's all connected for Infinity War. It's all connected for the future Avenger films. And no, it really wasn't. I remember, I don't know a lot about him. I remember reading the Infinity Gauntlet comic many years ago, probably when they announced Phase 3, and like, okay, Adam Warlock's this dude, and when that crazy happened, I was like, who's the gold casket? And obviously they say Adam, and you kind of, if you didn't know, you wouldn't know, but most people would have heard it if it did. It sounds really stupid, it's like every Marvel character, but I'm glad they didn't put him in any of the other films, and I think this is something James Gunn will set up. I think this is something we'll definitely see in the third Guardians film. I think Adam Warlock's too big a character in the comics to tease and then not really bring up. I'm not bothered if they don't, but I'd be very shocked at this moment in time, especially when you've got Elizabeth Debicki in it now, who was obviously setting up, and there was a mini, I guess, plot point with that stuff, which was a bit weird, a bit boring, but they serve as something. So I'm curious. That's the really big question to me that had me curious, like what's going to happen next.
Yeah, and I hope they do deliver on that, because otherwise it feels like a wasted scene. Like, they've set up this big comics character, and as someone who hasn't read the comics, even I've heard of him and I sort of know the character a bit. And it's like, if they set him up, they've got to do something with him now. They've teased him. They've said, we're going to do something with him. And if they don't bring him into the next one, or even at some point further down the line, like in the next few years, I think they definitely need to bring him in at some point now that they've set him up. Otherwise, that scene has absolutely no meaning. And it was sort of just filling a couple of minutes in the credits.
Yeah, hopefully they do more with him. I think this is like one of the issues with the film. And it was... they have these in franchises where they have a film where they have things that sets things up rather than being a film within itself. So this is setting up Adam Warlock, is set up Nebula joining the Guardians, bringing in a new character and removing Peter Quill's of like any sort of godlike person. And it kind of, that's kind of all it seemed to be doing throughout the film. So this kind of adds to that. Hopefully this will lead, it does. Because the other plot points definitely did. But yeah, I assume that they will, because Elizabeth Debicki is in the third one. So we'll have to. But yeah, it was a good one. And assuming they do something with it, it'll be a worthwhile setup.
Yeah, exactly. And you are right. You know, it's that whole setup dynamic where everyone goes and expects. I think of Marvel as well. Going off what we said at the beginning, that, oh, when they said there was five credit scenes, they're like, for like, pushing it to two was already sort of quite a gap. You have you always have the setup credit scene and the comedy credit scene, whereas this one did do maybe too much setup. And I think another one which we knew we'd have a payoff for Infinity War, that we had Teenage Groot. That's probably my favorite I Am Groot line from the films, was that really weird sort of teenage one when he's like doing the Groot in a really weird way. I'm not being horrible, it sounds the most like Vin Diesel ever has in absolute truth. But I thought it was funny, and also it was that reminder that, listen, in Infinity War he's not going to be a baby, we need him to be a certain age. And I think that was a smart way for them to maybe prepare the audience for Infinity War with how he's going to be. And I know it's not that important, but it would have been weird if he rocked up as he was in Infinity War with no questions asked and no nothing.
Yeah, I think you're definitely right there, that that's really important, that they show that next stage of his growth and development, so that by the time you see him again, you sort of know that he's a bit older now. And to be honest, I liked Baby Groot the most, like, so it was a bit of a shame to see him now as a teenager, or treenager, as I like to call him. But it was definitely a funny post-credit scene, because some of the other ones, like, whilst the one with Kraglin was, then you had the original Guardians, and then the one with Adam Warlock, which sort of aren't as funny. So it was nice to have a funny credit scene now, because this is the fourth one, was it? So at this point, you've sat through a lot of credits. It was quite a nice, funny moment to get at this point in the credits.
Yeah, it was definitely good. It definitely showed like a sort of stereotypical teenager or treenager, as you just called him, which is a great name, great thing to call him, I think. Yeah, I thought that was really funny. I really liked it. I think we cut things down, I must admit, and just have like the Adam one and this, and that's it. I didn't mind there being that many in the end, but because they were so short, but really they didn't really need them. This is a really good one and really enjoyable. I think I'll have to watch it once again with Vin Diesel's voice in my mind, like proper Vin Diesel voice, and try and compare, because he's got quite a mumble growl normally, so that's probably fairly typical teenager talk.
Yeah, it's the only time I've ever seen it. The Vin Diesel behind the scenes on I'm Groot is amazing. It's just Vin Diesel being Vin Diesel, and I absolutely love him. I love Fast and Furious. Doesn't matter how ridiculous it is, they're amazing for that precise reason. They are ridiculous. And not to get into Fast and Furious discussion, but my analogy of the Fast and Furious franchise, which is absolutely bang on, and I'll claim this forever. So Vin Diesel, it is Shakespeare. It is his written work, his life's work. To The Rock, it is a piss take. He's there to have a good laugh, and so will we. So, and now you can't look at Fast and Furious without knowing that. Less Fast and Furious talk, because they keep delaying it. Final one, also a kind of, Stanley's got, I guess, two cameos, but one's in the credit, one's not. One of my favourite ones of the entire MCU, which is Stanley being one of the Watchers. I love this because it was always a, not theory, not like a WandaVision theory or something like everyone's going to be furious if it's not real, but I loved the really sort of positive chat that Stanley's cropped up in so many of these films, that he's kind of like a watcher. He's watching over them. And I think for James Gunn to sort of not, I don't want to use the word read into it too much, but for James Gunn to sort of nod his head, go along with it for, as a laugh about why not? And I love that we got the Watchers in this. They look weird, but Stanley chilling with them, I thought was amazing. And I think it was one of like the perfect cameos for him for these films, was just him talking. I think he even mentioned the Civil War one. It's like, you know, and then I was wearing a FedEx thing as well. And I thought one of my favorite Stanley cameos, but a really nice credit scene. And I know there are five of them, and I'm happy that that one was one of the last ones, because if you're pissed off, there's already been four, Stanley pops up, you can't be angry. It's like, oh, it's Stanley, and I'll watch it and be fine.
Yeah, it's definitely one of his best cameos. So even if you haven't seen all the theories about him being a Watcher, or even if you don't quite know what a Watcher is, even just the way that he does reference his Civil War cameo, he's like, oh, I was a FedEx driver, and it was like, oh, that was him in the last film. And it's quite nice that they connect them all, or at least like they set it up so that they're all connected, and you think, oh, he's playing the same guy now. And it's quite fun, it's quite nice. And then seeing him again, because you've already seen him earlier in the film, it's quite nice having two cameos for him. And it's definitely the best idea that this was the last one, because it is quite funny, it's quite nice, it's good to see him again, and the way that it ends, so he's just all alone there, and it was quite nice. I liked that one.
Yeah, it is a really funny one. I like the sort of the callbacks to his other cameos. Apparently people have said it's quite problematic though, because so Guardians 2 is set shortly after Guardians 1, but Civil War is set sort of a couple of years after. So there's all those sort of mismatching of timelines. So I found that really, like, I mean, this is like super nerdy going really into it, but I'm quite here for it. I find it interesting. But yeah, I liked it. I thought it was funny. It didn't really bother me at the time. No, it really does. I hate that people pointing that out.
Yeah, it just triggers something inside of you. Like when you get Marvel, which is pretty much like perfect of a timeline, there's going to be someone that's furious about that. I'm fine. I'm pretending you didn't tell me, actually. I'm not going to lie, because I will think about it. But it's Stanley being Stanley in probably the best possible way he could have done it, being a watcher. So full credit for James again. And I think his last few cameos, I think, did they say that he would go into a studio and he'd film about 4 or 5 in one day? So I can imagine, like, I mean, the amazing feature at Endgame when they talk about him on set with them all, but you can imagine for those directors getting the chance to be like, so how do we want to get Stanley into this? They'd have probably had so much fun with it. And definitely one of my favorite ones. I've kind of said everything I can about Guardians of the Galaxy 2. I don't even know if I've got anything to add before we go over sort of like final thoughts or anything like that, because I don't know what else I can add, being polite.
Just one final thing I want to say about it is I think the humour in this one really works. And I think when you watch it again, it still seems really funny. Like, I remember watching some of the other funny ones, like Ant-Man and Thor Ragnarok, watching them again and again and sort of not laughing as much as I remembered in the cinema. And I was thinking, I found this funnier when I first saw it. But then with Guardians 2, every time I rewatch, there are still lots of jokes that I laugh out loud and that I find really funny. And I think the humour holds up on multiple rewatches, which is really good, because some of the other films don't do that as well. So I really like that aspect, that even when you watch it for the 4th or 5th time, it's still really funny.
Yeah, I'm going to disagree with that completely. I found it mildly funny the first time, and then it just gets worse with it. And with Ant-Man and the other ones, which are funny, I think they're still funny now. I'm going to disagree. I think this is definitely one of the sort of bottom tier Marvel movies for me. And I think that's partly just to do with how good the first one was in comparison to this, and how little of an impact it had on the MCU. But as a film itself, it just isn't that great. There are some very good moments, but ultimately not the best.
I'm kind of in the middle of you both. I've a lot of fun with the film, but I've also got a lot of issues with it, in that, you know, you'll get like some really good stuff, and then there'll just be something where I kind of like phase out, like, oh, okay. You know, just take me back to the Ravagers and Yondu, please. So it is a very weird one. I think Marvel set a barrier so high, not just for blockbusters, but their own franchise, that, you know, I'm going to go out on a limb and say, to me, the only bad MCU film is the, not the Incredible Hulk, is Thor the Dark World and Iron Man 2. Ooh, I don't know, that's a bit discussion for overtime, but I think when you're going off the back of Guardians 1, you're coming out on the back of Doctor Strange and Civil War, and coming up is Infinity War and all these other things. And it's kind of there, like, you know, the fact to me, this film is average, but the polite kind of average. And there are some stuff that works really well, some that doesn't. It's really interesting hearing other people's thoughts on it, because especially when it is comedy, I think comedies are always the one where you do get the most discussion, that does it hold up, does it not? And it's been interesting to have both you two's thoughts on it, because I think I sit quite nicely in the middle for this one. But either it's just nice to get them back on screen with another, and it is that lightning in a bottle to me. I don't think you can get that twice. Now, whether the third one can deliver on that, be something so completely different, or is it going to follow on from maybe something that's set up in Thor, I don't have the faintest clue. So I'm intrigued. But either way, for what does come next, you know, we know that the current cosmic threat was Thanos, and he's gone. Will Guardians be teeing up something else? I don't know. I'm not going to get into theories or ridiculous stuff, but I'm excited to see them come back for a third time. I think, to me, that's the goal, that if this film had gone so bad where I don't want to see them again, that would have been atrocious. But I think there's just so much enjoyment to have with them, where I'm kind of sold with them. But aside from that, I want to hear from everyone else at home for your thoughts of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Let us know your thoughts, not just on the characters, on the soundtrack, on Kurt Russell. Things you do like, stuff you don't like. This again has been quite a delight. It's been a really fun one, something a bit different. But what I'm going to do while I bring that up, I'm of course going to bring up our schedule, as we always do. Next up is a film called Spider-Man Far... Not Far... I get the mix up all the time. I'm so sorry. The next one coming is Spider-Man Homecoming. There are so many... I never thought there'd be a Spider-Man trilogy that has home as the key theme to it. I'm just glad it's not called Spider-Man 3, but the first of the Tom Holland solo films is going to be coming Monday the 5th of April. I'm actually looking forward to that one because I adore Michael Keaton in it. He's one of my favourite Marvel villains, so I am excited, believe it or not, to give it a rewatch. But that is the next one. There's a lot more things coming on the channel, of course. These videos, it's not ending with Spider-Man Homecoming, so I'm going to end with Spider-Man Far From Home. There's a final video planned, which we'll unveil later on in the series. However, I'm going to bring up some of the places where we can find you guys at. So, Neil, I've got your Facebook and Twitter usernames here as well.
Hello, I'm at underscore Neil's Real Deal at pretty much all social media platforms. Find me, follow me, but not in real life.
And Jeff?
You can follow me on Twitter, filmaddict123, where you can find some of my movie reviews, or on YouTube. My channel's called Wagman Studios. You can find I make some cool Marvel edits and mashups there.
Definitely. So everyone do check those out. It's been a really good day to have you guys on. I'm excited to see what we're all going to be on next. I think I have an inkling, but there is a big Marvel team of film happening. So maybe on this series, there'll be a big team of film happening too. Maybe half the people get blips at the end of it. I don't know yet. None of us know. So as always, if you want to find out when we're doing videos, what is coming next, hit us up on our social medias, which is Facebook at Cinema Savvy, Twitter at Cinema underscore Savvy, letterboxd.com/CinemaSavvy. And of course, we have a link to TeePublic below. And I am going to sort of do a really awkward farewell. I thought I had something else to say, but I really don't. Maybe that sums up my thoughts on Guardians of the Galaxy 2. I don't have anything more to say. So with that in mind, I want to thank you all for watching, and be sure to join us for the next one. See you later.